Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming and for joining us via online. With great pleasure, I would like to introduce Betsy DeSalvo and Blair McIntyre, both professors in the School of Interactive Computing, Georgia Tech. Betsy leads the Culture and Technology Lab, which focuses on research studying cultural values and how they impact technology use, learning, and production. Betsy received a PhD in human-centered computing from Georgia Tech. Blair leads the Augmented Environments Lab, which focuses on understanding the potential of augmented reality technology. And Blair received a PhD from Columbia University. I think Betsy will start presenting, so please, and then Blair, please join me welcoming Betsy and Blair.
Hi, thank you. So we're going to be talking a little bit about how we've been working to integrate studio pedagogy and computer science classes, particularly with projection AR is a project that we're going to be addressing here. But I want to give you some background on myself and on this project. So while I have a PhD in computing, my undergraduate degree is in studio arts with an emphasis in ceramics. And so my baseline for kind of understanding a learning experience or an expert learning experience comes from the studio experience, where everybody would have objects out all the time in different phases of the process that they were working on. In this public workspace really encouraged students to talk to each other, to ask questions about what each other was doing. And also there was a lot of practices within the studio that talked about sort of casual kind of pin-up interactions where students would talk about work in progress or more formal critique process. And sometimes, you know, when we're presenting this, we talk about it as being this, it sounds very warm and fuzzy, but in reality, studio arts practice or design-based practice, these critiques and this kind of continual critical thinking and reflection on your work in a public space can be pretty tough, and it's actually pretty tough to take. Students learn how to take criticism, they learn how to deliver criticism, and they also develop a pretty thick skin about it. So I think these are all qualities that we might want to see a little bit more inside of our computer science classroom. So just to give you some idea about I think this is an interesting picture because it shows you a little bit about how these studios work. Sure, they have pieces out, everybody's head down working on what they have, but if you notice, there's mirrors behind every wheel. And one of the reasons that you do that inside of a ceramic studio is that so you can see exactly the techniques someone is using from various angles, right? And this is, you know, something we don't think about in studio arts is how much we focus on technique in addition to, and technical skills, in addition to sort of the theoretical ideals or the artistic vision, right?
What? Protecting goggles.
Why is he wearing
it? That could be because he's going to go do glaze mixing after this, or he's going to, actually, they look dark, so he's probably been working with a raku fire. They work with fire a lot. I like fire a lot too, so thus I was a ceramics major. Okay, all right, so, you know, a computer science classroom, a typical computer science classroom is actually quite different than this. And while inside computer science classrooms, we often use project-based work or design-based learning interventions, one of the ways that this is usually implemented inside of a computer science classroom is that students work solo throughout the semester, and then at the big midterm or the final, they present their work. And that's the only time they get this sort of interactive experience within the classroom. And you know, this isn't actually, I think this is one of the nicer computer science classrooms I could get a picture of, quite honestly. It's pretty colorful and nice, so I'm not trying to give you the worst case scenario here. But one of the things that does happen often inside of computer science classrooms at the undergraduate level is that we have people that feel like outsiders. And this is actually a current Microsoft employee who is an African-American student at Georgia Tech several years ago that I worked with. And he told me, Me and some of my Black friends were talking about the guys in CS. Some of them have been programming since they were 8. We can't compete with that. Now, the only thing that I've been doing since I was 8 is playing basketball. I would own them on the court. I mean, it wouldn't be fair. They just would stand there and I would dominate. And it's sort of like that in computer science. So his first year in computer science, he felt like this all the time, like everybody was just dominating in the classroom. And he was so far behind, and he would never catch up. Because so many of the students coming into computer science have had experience, previous experience, programming, taking robotics camps, other things like that. So they come into the program knowing quite a bit and being quite confident in their skills. One of the things that this has done is it set up defensive environments often inside of computer science classrooms. And the work of Jane Margolis and Laisha Barker really has outlined some of these problems. It means that students will oftentimes raise their hand inside of a computer science classroom to show off what they know. And they rarely raise their hands to ask a question because they're trying to learn something, right? So the standard there is about kind of showing off and, you know, presenting sort of this really self-confident attitude inside the classroom. And what it does is it sets up a classroom that's not welcoming, particularly not welcoming to people who don't have this previous experience. And as I think you all probably know, the people who don't have this previous experience are oftentimes females and people from underrepresented minority groups in the U.S. So it makes them feel like outsiders, like this, the quote I showed you before. It's also frequently taught as a solitary activity where there's very little collaboration. And reasons for this are multiple. Teachers do this because they're afraid of cheating. Sometimes they allow for pair programming, but that's pretty limited inside CS classrooms, although it's shown to be quite effective. But it's taught as a solitary effort most of the time because they're afraid of cheating. It's really difficult to do assessment when you have multiple students working on a project at the same time. And this actually sets up a whole environment where there's a fear of collaboration. And it also has set up an environment where students are in competition with each other for grades, right? So if you help somebody else, that might mean that you help them get a better grade, which is going to hurt your grade in the long run, right? And so that's another reason why collaboration is kind of shut down within the CS classroom. Oh, it's common in other engineering programs. Actually, that thing about preparatory privilege is more common in computer science than in engineering, because not everybody walks into their first engineering class as an undergraduate with, like, I got all this engineering experience and kind of shows off in that way. But in CS classes, that happens more frequently, yeah. But the other things, totally. Although sometimes engineering is a little bit more conducive for project work. It depends on the type of engineering we're talking about. So I've been working for a few years to bring some of those studio practices that we talked about into the computer science classroom. And one of the ways I've been doing this, I've been partnering with Gregory Abaud, who teaches mobile and ubiquitous computing at Georgia Tech, as well as HCI, and also a graduate level prototyping class. One of the ways that we've been doing this is integrating maker-based activities into the classroom. And so the affordances of this are great because these are visually kind of interesting projects students are working on that everybody can see what everyone else is doing in the classroom. And it really encourages the students to both share materials and tools and skills, ask questions from each other, and they can get a good sense where everybody else in the class is. Also, one of the things that we've seen here and we saw, you can see in a studio too, is that students would oftentimes fail with what they're doing and then have to iterate and try again. And that productive failure is something that other people in the classroom were able to see. And so they were more comfortable trying new things and failing publicly, right? Rather than holding everything back until the very last second and then showing it when it's too late to actually improve their learning outcomes in any way. Some of the things that we've been focusing on this is some theoretical constructs from the learning sciences, and specifically I've been looking at the community of learners this establishes. And so this is more than just a classroom of students working together. It's really about thinking about a community of learners means that when I walk into a classroom, I can act as a student, a teacher, a collaborator, someone who brings different people together in terms of networking, or maybe I'm that person within a community of learners that helps, you know, you take that thing that you've just learned in class and match it to something in the outside world. It's taking on a variety of different roles that a learner or a community of learners takes on, rather than just being the student who is absorbing the knowledge within the classroom. So we have noticed a lot of this happening within these maker oriented learning environments. And we think that it's very encouraging. And the students have actually reported back to us that they like the fact that these classes aren't just them talking to the other people in their project group, but it's also them talking to people across project groups. And that's been beneficial for them to learn a greater breadth of information in the class. Another thing that we've been looking at is specifically how students are able to reflect on their own learning process and reflect upon their own projects to think about this in a metacognitive way. What have I learned? What else do I need to learn? Like, what am I missing here? And that metacognitive process is kind of a the building block for all learning that happens. It's almost impossible to learn something unless you can recognize the fact that you need to learn it, right? The reflection is taking place through a lot of our critique sessions. Having these sort of iterative critiques as they go on, both casual and a little bit more formal ones, has been very useful for the students to start to learn to reflect on a regular basis in their work and to see this in other students as well. I will say that the critiques has been a real challenge, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit later on as we get into the AR studio environment as well. And then kind of the last piece, and I don't have as much data on this. We just did our comparative study last week during finals with a standard HCI class, a standard, like, traditionally taught HCI class, and we had done it last in the fall semester with our more experimental class with the maker-based learning. What we've done is given them both the same design question, and what we're looking at is to see how much they transfer in that they've learned from other classes into this class, because part of our theory here is by exposing them to these maker activities and this greater variety of sort of ways to integrate ideals and computing into their own projects, they're going to start drawing on outside resources more and start being able to make those unusual connections, maybe increase innovation, perhaps, might be a way to put it. I glanced at them, like I rifled through all the data, of course, and I think that we're seeing that there is a greater transfer from outside, but one of the things that we may have lost with this is some of the central principles in terms of teaching HCI may have been lost within the maker-oriented learning. So that means that we have to recalibrate what we're doing within that classroom. I think it's good to note that kind of thing to say this isn't a silver bullet, right? For every gain, there may be a loss in relationship to that, and you have to make choices. So as I mentioned, there's two practices from the studio model that we've been trying to integrate. One of them is pinups, and we think of pinups as very casual sort of interactions that can happen on a daily basis. It's that stuff that's just, you know, out that we can talk about while it's in progress. The other is meetups, and this is students who are working together in the studio. They get to look at each other's work, and it's the casual meetup that happens. It's not something that is pushed by the faculty members. It's something that students are doing on their own. So these are the two things that we're sort of looking for specifically within these spaces, trying to integrate into the spaces. You know, but unfortunately, maker-based activities don't work for a whole lot of computer science classes, right? There's a lot of things that this doesn't apply to because it just simply isn't possible to teach the concepts we want with these physical prototyping. So that kind of brings us to the problem. How can we make visible the process of learning within computation? How can we present this within other classrooms in our computer science curriculum? And then how can we expose the hidden digital work that the students are doing so that they can start having these types of interaction? So I'm going to hand it over to Blair for a minute.
Thank you. So I just want to talk briefly about the technology setup, what we've done, and how we got there, and then I'm going to hand it back over to Betsy to talk about the sort of results of this first semester. So as Jaime introduced at the beginning, I'm Blair McIntyre, and I've been doing augmented reality for a long time. But notable for this project, I spent a summer at MSR working with Andy and Benko and the Room Alive team when they did this project. This is an image from one of the papers. And when I returned to Georgia Tech and this stuff got published, so I was allowed to talk about it, I gave a talk on a short talk on the work. And Mark Guzdile, who's a professor at Georgia Tech CS education, sort of made this connection between what Betsy was trying to do, what Betsy was doing with the maker stuff, and her goals with studio art pedagogy, and a potential use of augmented reality to solve this problem that Betsy just highlighted, this issue of how do we expose hidden digital work in a learning activity. And so So the three of us started talking. Before I go on, so if you're not for those not familiar with Room Alive, this is the video from the WIST paper. This might be the one on the MSR website. But the idea with Room Alive was to use projection AR, to use essentially take a room, use a bunch of Kinect sensors so that we can map out both the static physical structure, but also the action and interaction in the space. And be able to, and then use projectors, calibrate the whole thing so that you can project everywhere, tell what people are doing, and create these kind of experiences. And this is part of a long, ongoing thread of research that folks here have been doing. For us, the key part was that they open sourced a bunch of the underlying technology so that we could take advantage of it and get our students to try to build it. So we've set up a space similar to the one that they illustrate in this video. We have a bunch of projectors on the ceiling and have calibrated the space so that we can project on all the surfaces. Okay, so to sort of rephrase the questions that Betsy asked at the end of when she stopped talking, the question that we really wanted to pose with this project was, can we create sort of a studio learning experience for STEM in general, but for, in our case, intro to computer science, such that we can expose the work in progress of the students. So just as Betsy described ceramics and the idea that students can go and see what people are doing, not just the finished piece, but watch how they are working, what they're doing when there's a failure, which can be kind of a dramatic event if it sort of collapses in on itself, and either offer, I don't know, it could be, could offer assistance, could learn from things like, oh, that happened to me, how did you fix it, you know, and so on. Can we take that and create that in a computer science class? So Betsy will talk more about the class, but essentially we wanted to apply it to an intro computer science class that we have at Tech that's very visual, where we called Media Computation, where we use imagery, use very visual media to teach computer science concepts because we thought it would map well. Okay, so this idea of using AR for using augmented reality to display information around us in our periphery that might be useful is not new. In fact, it's kind of the central idea behind a lot of what makes augmented reality exciting to people. And this idea of projecting information around the rooms is also not new. We actually had a project, I pulled one of the projects we'd done years ago at Georgia Tech at the turn of the century, love saying that, where what we wanted to do was project information all around that had been gleaned from someone's work on a computer. And so what you see in this picture are sort of image montages that represent different tasks people have been working on that were snapped automatically from the desktop as they were working. And the long-range vision of this project was that by showing you the past work that you've done, we could both help you regain state when you wanted to resume a task, be reminded of the task that might not be finished, kind of like the messy desk, which is why we have these sort of messy things. And you could do things like annotate them and integrate other stuff. So this and other projects over the years, people have envisioned this idea of having your hidden digital world visible. One of the things that wasn't so common, which I thought was really interesting with the idea of applying Room Alive to this educational activity, is the sort of passive nature of the augmented reality, right? I think if you talk to a bunch of people about augmented reality education, they're mostly thinking about, I want to use augmented reality to teach you how to do something, right? I'm going to use it for math, or I'm going to use it to teach you how to repair something. Here, the activities that the students are engaged in are completely divorced from the augmented reality in the focal task, right? They're programming, they're manipulating pictures. The AR is being used to create this pedagogical environment, this pedagogically beneficial environment that we hope will change and improve the educational environment. So we use Room Alive as the basis, the Room Alive software as the basis for being able to display everywhere. We're not yet leveraging some of the more advanced capabilities of the system, which I'll refer to later. And then we wanted, but to do this, we had to be able to capture the students' work without them doing anything. We didn't want this, if we asked the students to select a picture and share it, that would have defeated the whole purpose, because then they would have no motivation to share it. We wouldn't be seeing this work in progress. So we took advantage of the class uses Python. So we took advantage of this web-based Python programming environment from Virginia Tech called Pithy. And so Pithy runs on a server. We set up a Pithy server for the lab, for this project. And we modified it. So every time in this Python environment an image gets shown, we write it out to the database, grab a copy of the image, grab a copy of the code, save all kinds of other metadata that we might need. And then the software that's driving the projectors for Room Alive is just watching this database using a remote SQL connection. And every time a new entry appears for one of the students in the class, we just grab a copy of that image, which is accessible on the web server, and pop it up, right? So relatively simple, but it allowed us to do this sort of very passive background environment. The technical physical setup was 5 projectors, 1080p high resolution projectors, relatively wide field of view set up in this space. This is an image of the reconstruction that was created from the Room Alive calibration. So we have a relatively large room. There's desks in the center that aren't showing up here because we didn't calibrate down that low. 3 walls, the door is over here. These are actually windows that we covered up because obviously that would create, the light would create problems. We actually then could project there as well. Here's another view of the same space. So in this space, we can project here, here, and here, and then actually kind of over here, there's a normal projector that the instructor uses to project their slides. And so you'll see some images of the space. You'll see students sitting largely here looking that way because they're looking when the instructor's talking at them and seeing sort of in their periphery a lot of this other content. Okay, the content is rendered relative. This is a snapshot of sort of just the virtual content in the 3D world. Each student has a space with their most recent image when it was updated, and now we're just using their initials. At the time when we first did this, we used whatever name they registered in the Pithy server with, so everybody has accounts. And so using that, we get something like this, right? Students sitting around working and content spread around the walls behind them, very large, so they can really see what's going on. When there's changes, they're very visible because it changes immediately. And so this led us create this environment where the students are working and seeing the work in progress constantly around them in the lab.
Just the one next to me that I converse with, I actually don't see his work.
Well, so his work may be anywhere in the room, right? So there's a lot of technical questions, and we had lots of fantasies about things we would want to do when we started this work, right? So, you know, I presented the Room Alive stuff, which was very, in some ways, sophisticated. In the video, you see people running around and touching, and it's like we should be able to know where people are and all this. So we had ideas early on of should this person's work be behind them, right? Or should we maybe put someone on the desk? How can we tell? And because we wanted to get it working and be robust, we didn't want to rely on some form of tracking of the 12 to 15 students at once and knowing which one was which and all this. These are all ideas that we want to explore, which we'll return to at the end. So I'm going to hand it back to Betsy to talk about the results.
Yeah. So what we did this semester is looked at 2 different classroom conditions. One is the traditional model with an instructor projecting with a normal projector in a classroom and students working at their own class laptops, as you would normally know. And the other one is a studio model, which Blair just described using the AR technology. So we both have the instructor and the students projecting. And we did observations and interviews this spring in both of these conditions. And these were in recitations for our undergraduate media computation class. And this is entry-level CS course for non-majors. So traditionally it's taught as a 300-person class and a lecture, and then once a week they meet for a recitation or a lab session. The first condition, the studio condition that we were looking at, there was 12 students, 2 instructors, and one of those instructors was actually Mark Guzdile, who wrote the book quite literally on media computation and was a person who kind of invented this whole thing and came up with the entire class. So that was really well taught. The other condition was the traditional recitation with 50 students, two instructors who were both undergraduate TAs. And I'm telling you this because I am not comparing these two things. I know they are not equal, right? We're looking at this as much more of a qualitative discovery process to understand what the differences are in these kind of classes.
The subject of the course is something that has a more visuals.
Yeah, so media computation is about using computation to manipulate media, and about half of that course is based off of visual media. Some of it is based off of sound. What are some other aspects of it?
Web
type stuff, yeah. So there's a lot of visual elements to the class that you can project. And that's actually an interesting question. We'll talk a little bit about that later, like what can you project in what classes? Yeah, we did observations and interviews with the students. Actually, our semester ended last week, at the end of last week. So actually, there might be finals today. I don't know. We're not done with our interviews. And we certainly haven't done a deep analysis of this data. But we have some preliminary findings, and it's really promising. And first of all, the thing that we have looked at quite closely is our observation notes. And within the studio condition, students noticed and commented on their peers' work at least once, usually actually multiple times in every single one of the classes when this was happening. In contrast, in the traditional model, the students never commented on each other's work unless the instructor specifically asked them to work together in peer groups or present something that they found out loud, unless they were prompted to. So there's none of this spontaneous interaction happening in the traditional model. And so this is one of the things that we were looking for. We also noticed the students gained inspiration from each other. This picture of Donald Trump, this is a kind of amusing anecdote. One of the students manipulated this to turn him green, and I think eventually put little ears on him so he looked like Shrek. The other students thought this was very amusing and wanted to do the same thing with other images. And so from that, they riffed off each other's work. They basically remixed each other's computational code, and they were able to come up with different ideas. And this is exactly what you kind of want to see happening in a studio environment as well, this inspiration. One of the other things that we saw is that students sought help based upon the projections that were in the room. And this is a great quote from one of our interviews. So the student liked it a lot. But what she also noticed is that when people had completed the task and she wasn't done or she was struggling with something, she saw that. And then she was able to ask those people for help, right? And then when she saw one of her friends perhaps struggling, not completing the task, she was able to reach out to them and offer help to those students. And that rarely actually happens in computer science classrooms. So this we felt was a very encouraging sort of behavior happening in the classroom as well. Another thing that we didn't anticipate makes sense in retrospect is that a few students have told us that they could measure their progress within this classroom. So if they could see that everybody else had completed the next task, right, within the lab. Yeah, go ahead.
Question on the visuals here, the white rectangle, what is that?
That's a window.
That's a window, yeah.
Yeah. Physical UI.
Yeah. So they could see when they were falling behind, and then they could actually reach out to the TA or the instructor to ask for help, right? And that's not something that happens often inside of a CS classroom because you're working solo. You don't see how far behind you are from the rest of the class or how far ahead you are.
I have a question.
Sure.
So are you able to see activity live on each one of these panels? Is that how it works? So
yeah, so every time they run their program.
Sort of like, you know, you see everyone's on this one or like.
No, it's like one per person.
One per person.
Right, but are you also showing their update real time as they, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, cool. So every time they run their code, it updates the image.
Okay, and yeah. Are you also able to just focus on one? So you could just, could you select one and just everyone looks at it? Or
I would really like to do that. Okay. Yes, I can. We cannot do that yet. Yeah. But this is a class of 12, so we were able to do that in some ways just by walking over to it and say, look at this, right? And that's a lot of what happened. So even if stuff might be projected behind me, if somebody else noticed it, I just turn around, you know? So that was okay in this particular environment, right?
Like a regular class, true that this has much more visibility, but do you have there, also if someone would have put in the Trump image on his laptop with his neighbors or someone behind you, will look at it and say, oh, that's cool.
They might, yeah, and that might might have, we didn't observe it in the traditional classrooms that we saw in this particular case. I can certainly see that happening, but it would be a small group, and it'd actually be kind of discouraged within the classroom to have that kind of talk going on while the professor is teaching, right? So this is an environment that encourages it rather than discourages it, and that's part of setting a precedent.
Although even in this environment, if a professor right now talks, would you see the background changes and the professor knows that instead of listening to him, someone is doing something?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that would happen too. And knowing what your students are doing as a professor is actually a good thing, not a bad thing. Mark, who was our instructor, also found the whole process really helpful for him. And he's an expert teacher, has been teaching for many years in this class for many years. But some of the things that he felt were unique about this is that it was a chance for him to let the class be student-led rather than instructor-led. And engaging students in active learning inside the classroom is actually something almost all institutions are trying to do more of right now, but it's really difficult for professors to do that. They don't have much experience with active learning. They're used to standing on the stage and presenting their slides and not having students interact with each other during the classroom. In some ways, this acts as a forcing function so the students start leading part of the learning process, which, you know, could be very beneficial. Implications for this is that the teachers may need to explicitly provide permission to the students that they can interact. So these students have been well trained to be good students, and they know not to talk to their neighbor or interrupt during class, and we need to let them have the permission to do that. So you need to give them explicit instructions to them that that's available, and maybe set a precedent for it as well, model that behavior. Training is really needed for the teachers to try and integrate this into their classroom and into their classroom practices. So the TAs taught a couple of the sessions within the studio classroom when Mark was traveling. The things that we observed inside that classroom were that the TAs actually did not point at anybody's images that were up on the wall or engage the students in any way. The students were still doing it. They were doing it despite the TA trying to present their slides and only present their slides. But the TA probably needed to be given some guidance and instruction on how to lead a class with this technology. So that's another challenge that we kind of face. And finally, students need help to learn how to critique. They didn't really know how to talk about each other's work. Computer science instructors aren't necessarily well-versed on how to lead a critique themselves. This is something that we're struggling with in the maker-oriented learning as well. There's a few techniques that we're using to address this. It is just a matter of training and getting people used to this way of looking at each other's work critically, commenting on it in a productive way, and sort of making that a cycle to help each other both learn and iterate on their projects so that they're better. Sure.
So, I mean, this is kind of a generalization, but it's sort of inferred that a lot of folks who are in CS are very introverted by mm-hmm. nature, and they don't want to share or they don't want to get up in front of the class. Mm-hmm. The thing about the critique model is that you're very exposed to that, right? You're like, oh my gosh, everyone's looking at me. And that, have you noticed any interesting transitions from sort of typical introvert behavior to more sort of like getting comfortable having your work exposed in real time, getting up and talking about it? Have you seen any interesting developments around that?
So the students are, I have more experience with this in the maker-oriented learning environments. So the students are pretty comfortable working in their teams and then getting up and presenting their work. There's occasionally a student in the class that's kind of terrified of presenting, and that's actually in all classes, I think. Yeah.
I actually, in fact, continue to that. What if someone wants to explore new thing, uh-huh. but is afraid that in the middle, or maybe that will not be successful, it will be presented to everybody?
Well, this is one of the things that the studio model actually encourages quite a lot, and we call it productive failure. That you're allowed to try new things and fail publicly because everybody's doing it. You've seen most of the class fail publicly in some way. So it's okay for you to go ahead and do that as well. Oftentimes when students are presenting in their computer science classrooms, project-based classes, they only want to present a success, and so they won't do something risky, right? It may encourage sort of risk, trying new things and risky behavior, learning new sorts of activities.
The other half of your question, and the reason we haven't seen stuff in the CS class is this is a non-major class.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
So none of the students in that class are CS majors.
Oh.
Hopefully
okay.
Some of them will be in the future.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, okay.
We have gained a few students from this CS media class into CS.
I guess the question I had also is, how much of it is class-wide critique, where you're standing up talking mm-hmm. about someone, versus the individuals going, hey, how'd you do that? Or hey, that more individual, which could be considered critique, but that helping critique. So I'm wondering, is there a 50-50 or is it more?
Yeah, so the big kind of formal stand up and present your work, get a critique is already happening in a lot of computer science classrooms. What we're trying to implement is a more casual, we call them pen-ups. Yeah. So it might be a small subset of the class or the whole class that kind of does this on a more intermediate basis rather than at the final project. But then the other thing we identify is we call meetups, which is when the students kind of facilitate this for themselves. And that's that very casual interaction.
My question, kind of what you were talking about, Asta, was if it's more an issue on the introverts on the large class versus the 2-3 type, it's a small group. Because mm-hmm. you're more apt to ask somebody else for help or, hey, how do you solve this in a safe zone.
Yeah.
And
I think that actually does then happen, that students are like, hey, how did you do that? And then they talk to each other. And that might address some of those introvert issues. But we haven't had a huge problem with the introvert issue. There's some students, but we haven't had a huge problem in the maker-based learning environments, which I was a little bit surprised by, frankly. They have a hard time doing the critiques because either the students tend to be just super aggressive and like difficult, or they won't say anything bad at all, right? Only, I think it's cute, you know what I mean? So we need to help them be more critical in that, right?
I would say that specifically in this media, there's things that when you show them at one point, they have a great impact, uh-huh. but if you see them in the middle, you will spoil the surprise.
What do you mean?
I might do a poster like that, where when you finish, you will see what I meant, and it will have a strong impact. But if you see it in the middle, on the least side, you might guess what's going to happen.
And you think it'll be a spoiler.
In the worst side, you might be too much critical, because you don't know where it's going.
I think that that is typically the way people in computer science think about this, and it's very different than the way that people in the maybe studio arts or design think about this process. And so I understand that, but I'm trying to actually change that.
Yeah, no,
right?
I'm drawing a cartoon, a caricature.
So it's kind of like
it works when it's finished. It doesn't work when it's middle.
I mean, think about it in terms of writing a novel or a story, right? People who write novels or stories workshop them frequently, where you're presenting a chapter or outlines or subsets of that story, and you're workshopping it with other people who are giving you iterative feedback on it. It helps you think more critically about what you're writing, may change the direction for it. But even though you have this big idea of what this is going to be at the end, I guess what we're proposing with this work is this kind of workshopping or iterative feedback is going to be more productive for you than you having your brilliant ideal presented at the end of the semester, right? Because the goal is for you to learn something, not to be the shining star in the classroom, right? So those may be different goals, right? Go ahead.
So I think one of the really interesting things is kind of almost the real-time nature of the presentation, mm-hmm. which is not necessarily, it might be the case with physical things, like if you're doing clay and pottery, but mm-hmm. if they're preparing their posters or something like that in more traditional sense, it might not be so immediate, right? You would have these pinups, but maybe on a daily cadence rather than mm-hmm. instant cadence. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering what your thoughts are about, would you observe similar needs or would there be a similar benefit if you literally, for makerspaces, just had a camera above every station and just like real-time share that? Or do you just like physically being able to glance over and see what they're doing is enough? In some sense, could you apply the same technique regardless of the fact that this is, you know, Python and mm-hmm. scripts and image manipulations in the background, you know, whatever we're doing, we're writing, but you're just magnifying my writing and exposing everything on the large, you know, for everything in real time, like this concept of real time sharing to the public, is that something that is the core benefit here? I don't know, like, what are your thoughts?
I totally, the other future work, other courses, and where else could we apply this in other group environments? Like, I had never thought about a writing environment for this, but maybe that would be, I mean, poetry writing, I actually think if we were posting everything up on the wall as we're writing poetry in real time, that could be fascinating and actually maybe perhaps quite beneficial, right? And I would think so.
Because okay, it's concise. What would you do in non-visual?
Yeah, no, and I mean, this isn't going to be the answer for every classroom, right? It's going to be the answer for certain classrooms, just like the physical computing is the answer in some classrooms, right?
I mean, I do it in math, too.
Yeah, you could totally do it in math.
It doesn't
yeah.
matter.
But the thing it reminds me of is that you always kind of get intrigued by is a bulletin board where when you walk by and something will catch your eye and you'll dig in more deep on the text,
mm-hmm.
right? So it's not that you always have to have a large visual. It may just be there's somehow your subconscious picks up a few words and then you're going to read the rest of it. And so there's something about, I actually like this where it's on the wall and it could
mm-hmm.
it'd be great to actually see it with text. You know,
mm-hmm.
could you imagine it when you guys do paper writing or something else like that, doing it that way where people could just quickly and kind of give impact on it.
You can extract key sentences.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's stuff that exists in the periphery, like in a studio space that you have all sorts of stuff on your shelf or on your easel or whatever it is, or even drawing spread around your table. It's that periphery that's happening. Other people can walk by and see it. And hopefully will be that moment of serendipity where like what I'm doing and what you do are doing kind of overlaps and makes a moment.
I know you guys are looking at courses in those, but it occurred to me that hackathons would be a great place because it's a limited time, you know, short amount, maybe the data science ones or those type of ones where
mm-hmm.
you're doing it over 24 hours, right?
That'd be
and
pretty
so
cool.
Getting the insight and the,
right.
We
you know,
can actually do that. They have
yeah.
hackathons in our building sometime. We could put them in that one
yeah.
group in that room and see what should
do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hackathon is actually
week.
Better than the slide that you show for the MAKE because for the MAKE, it seems like everybody was doing the same project.
Oh.
At least at that
it was
slide.
Just a picture.
Yeah,
it was a nice picture. That's.
Which I think it's much more helpful when
each one
is doing
different
things.
Things yeah.
So then
yeah.
ideas could flow.
You had a question.
You haven't really talked about the fact that you're now making more attention demands on the students.
Yeah.
Right? That somehow I'm supposed to be doing my little project here on my PC, and then I'm also supposed to be like looking around seeing what other people are doing.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, like, did you find that people kind of shut down and started watching the wall, or did they ignore the wall and sort of try to get work done?
We have a pretty small sample size right now.
Yeah.
So in our interviews and observations, so far we haven't seen that. I haven't dug through all the interviews, actually, and they haven't finished collecting them all by the time I left town. So we may see some of that, and I wouldn't be surprised by it. On the other hand, in the idea of treating this like periphery information rather than central information for the class, which is still happening on the projector that the professor is putting forward, it's the same thing that might happen in any sort of studio environment. I mean, it's a lot of heads down work. I mean, if that first picture I showed you with the people throwing pots, they weren't looking around the room, they were heads down. But when you get up to, you know, take a break, that's when you notice other things going on, right? So I mean, we all work in those kinds of environments on a regular basis. Is it going to be too much for the students? I mean, that would be a great question to look at and ask.
So
yeah.
In the project, the Kimura project that I showed a picture of that we did back in 2000, we actually ran studies with a psychology professor on change awareness in peripheral displays. So we had, you know, how fast can we change these things? How fast can we change the contrast so that you won't actually notice things in your peripheral vision. That stuff never got published because they moved buildings and the machines got stolen.
Who was the professor?
Greg Corso. He's retired
okay.
now. And we talked about other designs for this at different points, right? So you could imagine if every time you changed a picture, it tweeted right? You had like a, something that looked like a Twitter window, and there's this like constant motion on the side of your desktop. Mm-hmm. That would be horrible, maybe, because it would be impossible to ignore bang, bang, bang.
Right.
But if it's hopefully up in the periphery, it won't be.
So
but
right now, did this fade in or
no,
this just appeared?
They're just switching. This is like level zero.
Yeah.
Right.
You see the students whenever something switches.
Not really. I mean, they might put theirs up and then look around the room to say, "Oh, mine's up. Oh, look at what everybody else did." Right? Like that seems to be more the moment. When they run their program, they look for where it appears on the wall, and then they might look around the room to see where everybody else is.
Say if I'm working there, my display is in a fixed position.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we fixed the, there was 12 students, and we just fixed them. They were the same place.
So how aware are they about what they present?
About what they present?
Yeah.
They were pretty, they were aware.
Yeah.
They were aware of what they were presenting.
Did they comment? I mean, sometimes, you know, it went out to the public.
Yeah. Well, they certainly looked up to see if it did, right? So that happened. So I know that they were checking to see if it went out to the public. I was worried that some of the students would be embarrassed or concerned with this. Now, they did get to opt into the class. They chose to take this particular, they didn't really know what it was. But they opted into the class because it was perhaps held on a different side of campus at the right time of night for them. I think that's usually the motivation. They didn't know what technology we were using, but it was a smaller class too. They may have liked that. But we told them what it was about in the first, you know, day of class, and they could opt out. None of them did, but they could have. So it may be that we got students that were comfortable with this more than the average student classroom would be. Yeah.
A danger that, not a danger, that's a pretty heavy word, but do you think that there's a tendency for copying? You know, like, you see everything up there and you're like, oh, that's supposed to be what I'm doing. Like, then you sort of sacrifice your own direction in a way because you might feel collective pressure to do what everyone is doing. Like, how do you manage that? Like, there's learning and learning skill sets and getting that in your tool belt so you can create your new stuff, right? Mm-hmm. But how do you sort of balance the line between that and then sort of muting out like individual creativity or generating more homogeny in output?
Yeah. So I think that I'm actually addressing this with another project that I'm working on. But modeling what kind of the output is in a design is actually quite challenging because anytime you present a model for the students, they're immediately going to think that's the right way to do it, right? So what we're doing to address this is actually bringing out multiple models for the students to look at rather than just the faculty members or the instructors, like this is the best way to do it. Here's a good example. We want to give them good, bad, medium, just different examples. In some ways, I think this already facilitates that more so than what we're doing, right? Right now, we're giving them one model of how this is done, and now they're getting 12, right?
If you do, say you ask for people to draw something, okay, the same object, if they don't see what other people are doing, and you compare those drawings of the same object, while if you actually show how people are going, is there gonna be the spread will be smaller when people are affected from start by other people?
So that's a really good question. I'm not sure. And I actually think it depends a lot on the environment and kind of the cultural norms in the environment. If you were to give a drawing assignment, likely in a lot of art courses, you would see students actively looking at each other to try and do something different than their neighbor,
okay.
Right?
Okay.
Inside a computer science class, I'm not sure. And so that's actually a very interesting question, right?
Do you have any examples of how people use the system in a way that you didn't anticipate? Like, do you have hacks or?
No.
I mean, because ultimately, it's just literally presenting a picture up on a projector, right? But did they use it to like, hey guys, let's go to a bar afterwards?
So this is.
Is there any kind of hacking of the system that happened?
Well, that would have been a good idea. The person who chose the Donald Trump image might not have
Fair enough. Well, that's a good example.
Georgia Tech is in the middle of Georgia. I mean, we got really conservative students there, so the Donald Trump thing might have been a bit of trolling of the class, right?
Yeah.
The color green.
But I'm just kind of curious that people use it in a form that wasn't explicitly demanded by the instructor, suggested by the instructor, but actually kind of unexpected. Like, did people try to actually make a collage?
So,
that's what I was going to suggest.
Like,
exactly.
Like, is there any other?
We didn't see that this semester, and I think if we kept teaching in this environment, we would eventually.
Yes.
Yeah.
So.
On the subject, right?
Yeah.
And the subject, so for instance, if you're doing sort of, you know, political events, right, in real time, like, you can have people be journalists and, like, put stuff up, right? Versus, okay, now we're learning how to, you know, connect a circuit and we're doing this, versus you're going to see people
different things.
Eventually want to game it for different outlets.
And one of the things to keep in mind is we've been teaching this class for a long time, so any sort of crazy manipulation to the media we've seen, so it's hard to say that's unexpected because it's been happening for years. Now, maybe it hasn't been happening publicly for years, but
Mark did a lot of work early on with wikis. He was one of the founder pioneers of using wikis in an educational context. And in this class, students constantly would post their results on the class wiki. Would have a page that's like, hey, when you get a collage done, post it so everyone can see it. And so you would get that effect of, but now people are only posting their finished best work, right? So but that same effect would have happened, right? Where people are like, oh my God, that's cool. How do I, you know, I'm gonna copy that.
We can actually use that once you have the tool to do more things, like
Who
agrees, who disagrees, put a V or an X, and you see that on the walls, right? Or suggestions.
And that's really, I mean, this is the next step next semester that I want to take. We have some proof of concept here that this is working and getting some of the affordances we want for students, and it's certainly not studied fully in terms of the learning science context. But it's promising, right? So the next thing I would really like to do is understand what kind of gestures, what kind of interface, both desktop and physical interface, and what things we can do in the room. Like, I want to be able to go up and, you know, touch this screen and have something else come out and that exposes things for the students that otherwise wouldn't be exposed, right? I want to be able to grab maybe a picture over there and bring it to the front of the classroom and talk about that. And we're going to be doing some design research and participatory design activities with stakeholders to try and figure out what kind of design concepts we want to start building. And that's my next steps.
Yeah.
And that's what I'll be doing in the fall with this project.
Also, are you also integrating any sort of gamification around this? Like, is there like popularity if you have certain skill sets in certain areas, you can be an expert. Like, you can have profiles being built around the kind of content you're generating. Like, so I mean, would that be something you might?
You're like trying to say everything but stickers.
We almost had a messenger.
Right.
It is not something that we're focused on right now.
Sure.
I think that it kind of is counterintuitive to the philosophy that we're thinking about with the studio pedagogy, where it's not really about these. It's not about stickers or gold stars or things like that.
No,
it's really about building this.
An incentive to jump in and participate and getting some sort of accolade or moving, like, to keep going. Like, hey, like, you have like 10 thumbs up on this. Like, this is exciting.
So, I mean, a lot of the studies looking at learning in those kind of environments, they're very effective for about 6 months. And then it's a drop off as there's a saturation point where people just kind of stop. There's a few people that stick with it forever. Maybe you run.
So we are interested in knowing, this goes to the gestures and other stuff, knowing what things people look at, knowing things. So it wouldn't necessarily be that you'd give a thumbs up on an image like the Trumpy thing, although you might. This is one of the questions
that we're
interested in pursuing. Yeah. It's just like, do we have a desktop interface where you can say that? And you might not get a star for being always getting thumbs up images, but we would like to know that image was inspirational to people, because maybe we'll come back in the later semester and show that same image as an example when they're doing the same recitation, and it's detached potentially from you. So you're not getting, we don't want to necessarily encourage people to show off.
Or compete.
I think that there's some things that we can do with this, and particularly using the AR environment, where, you know, I can show that there's just a lot of activity around this particular thing, and maybe it's more subtle than, you know, a thumbs up, and maybe it's more of like a heat map type of thing on the floor, or maybe it starts pulsating and everybody's, And it's the same kind of thing that might happen in other environments that we can take advantage of with the AR, right?
How about actually copying and pasting from the display? I mean, not for to steal IP in this sense, but it's easier to comment or collaborate this way. I could take the Trump, do something, and show you can do this.
Yeah, and I mean, we're thinking about what does that desktop interface look like for the students? So, do I click on it on the desktop? Do I click on it physically? In the, I don't have the answer to those questions, but I think that there's some really fascinating interaction between, because you need both interfaces, right? Or maybe the students don't have any desktop interface for it and only an instructor. I don't know. But like that's, there's a broad range of questions here that we have to start figuring out.
And I think it goes back to the culture, too. Like, you can imagine a small room like this where a small group of students have been working and they're comfortable with each other. You could freely give them the ability to grab that an image, write on it on the desktop, and post it back. A 300-person classroom where there's a horde of images around with a group of computer science students who don't know each other and have never been in this environment, and it would just be troll central, potentially, right? You don't know what they would do. And so I think, who knows?
Yeah.
But so I think that I'm really excited about Betsy's idea to sort of step back without having to implement things, to just do some design-based research and figure out what do we need? What would be useful, do we think, right? And then figure out how to implement it and move forward. So like things like heat maps or, you know, is there a need to have stuff around the students on the desktop? Is there a need to sort of display more stuff? Do we want to integrate a Surface Hub at the front where we can like mark up things and throw things at the desktop and so on? It depends. We don't know yet.
Yeah, so those are some of the questions. And then
Claire
has some
more questions.
And so this
goes into technology, right? So part, in a sense, based on what we, once we finish these analyzing the data right now, based after we do some design and figure out what we want to do, there's kind of a ton of things we could do, right? And that's everything from like using a lot of the technologies that these guys have developed, right? Is there some of the stuff that we could integrate more? And potentially there's obvious simple things, like it would be really nice if the projectors weren't shining in your face when you're lecturing in this room. It would potentially be really nice if, as I walked around, if there was more dynamism on the walls and so on, right? If I put a real poster up here because I've printed something out, maybe the things move away so we're not over. There's just all kinds of things you could do once you decide how you're going to use the space. You know, better tools for prototyping these environments. I'm all about tools because I have a CS degree. Given this technology, if we have a new idea that a master student wants to sort of prototype a new kind of structure for the space, can we make that as easy as possible as opposed to requiring a certain level of technology mastery to build these things? You know, Microsoft is developing a whole set of APIs for augmented reality, right? The holographic APIs. And HoloLens as a technology is sort of this example of really being able to do AR in a real environment. Now, the current, you know, version isn't going to be something that we want these students wearing in the classroom while they're programming on their laptops, but it's just AR, right? I think there's a fascinating question of if we displayed the same information on a head-mounted display, you know, it's just same stuff around the walls, but now it's not sort of public. Even though I tell all of you people that you're all seeing the same thing, would that change what people do? It might totally destroy it, because deep down inside, I'm not necessarily convinced. But I would have then the option to display things personally. You know, I could have like all of my history and my code up there because it's my things, but I can't see your code and your stuff or whatever, right? So I think there's a lot of potential for exploring other ways of doing similar stuff. We were talking to one of the HoloLens team this morning and talking about running classes on AR, right? Well, you've got now a room with everybody wearing an AR display because they're programming it, right? Could we do the same thing where now the little AR thing you just ran, it's floating above your head in my view, right? So I see like AR everywhere and see the same kind of stuff. That would, might be kind of cool. And that particular context would enable it. I think that's it. Is that it?
You started with kind of motivational part of enabling CS students to appreciate more of a crit style evaluation and crit style classes. Do you feel like this room facilitated that, and do you feel like that students actually learn more, like that they appreciated and learned the, how to critique better? Because I kind of completely agree with you. I don't think that CS people are really versed or know.
They're just not trained on.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, do you feel like the people in there actually took your course better?
I can say with this augmented reality studio that that's probably not the case because we didn't really implement special measures to try and make that happen. Within the maker-oriented learning classrooms that we've been doing for 2 years, you know, we've added in sort of tools to help the students become better at critiques and also to help the faculty facilitate that better. And we have seen progress in that arena. So the first time that we ran crits, like there was 3 students in a class of 50 that said anything, and they were the only 3 students during the entire class who said anything. And that's not unusual in a CS class, right? And then we gave each one of the students a small half a sheet of paper that asked them 3 questions and said, please, you know, think of something good about this, you know, presentation, think of something critical about this presentation, and what is one suggestion for the presenters? And then we asked them to give feedback on one of those items for each presentation. So we got a lot more feedback. A lot of it was, yeah, that's cool. I like that idea, you know, because that's the easiest thing to give. Or as I mentioned before, sometimes it was just like really critical stuff that was like, I think your idea is stupid. That's never going to work, sort of a response. But as the semester went along using that tool, actually students got better at it, right? They saw when it was useful. They also got to experience. So sometimes the person in the class that is super aggressive gets the least amount of critique back at them because people don't want to become a target. It's a bit of a bully kind of situation,
yeah.
Right? But when they suddenly started getting critiques back, not that they were particularly negative, they started to maybe see, I hope they saw the function of them, but it did start to change the culture of the classroom a little bit over the course of a semester. I think I told you this earlier, we just tried something out this semester that's been, I think, more successful, was we gave out cards, and it's a little gamified too. We gave out cards to all the students, and they were asked to contribute one thing based off the prompt of the card, which was, what is something good about this presentation? Or the card might have said, what is something bad about this presentation? Or it might have said, what's something suggestion? Or, you know, what's a similar type of project that they should look at? It was several different prompts for them. We handed them out to the class. Everybody just got one. They only had to ask one or use one of these cards during the entire class period. And they wrote their name on it and then turned it into the TAs, because we have to still do that with the students. And that was by far the best critique that we've had, in the sense that all the students, 3 questions for each person was too much. They were so busy filling out the form that they couldn't really pay attention. Thinking of one thing was great. They waited till the end. They were able to think, reflect it for a minute and then fill it out, or not fill it out, but just ask the questions rather than filling out a form. They also were interested in trading cards. They're like, I can't think of anything bad to say. Can I use your positive card for my negative card? And so that happened too. Which is fine. I mean, that wasn't a problem at all. So it gave me hope that there's better ways to do this, and maybe we just need to work a little bit harder at it, right? And in this environment, I think it's different. And I think we're going to have to think about how to do critiques in a different way, right? These aren't CS majors particularly for this class, but I'm eventually mostly interested in applying this in CS classes so that we can kind of change that culture.
Successfully flipped a CS class? I've never heard of it.
Successfully flipped a CS class?
Yeah.
Well,
Is that actually
Jim Foley
like,
and
they watch the lecture
style
and they come in and
there's a bunch of people doing that at TAC.
Yeah.
Okay, but that's are they is that like CS 101 or is it like CS 200?
CS higher. So Jim did 3,000 level. Jim Foley did a 3,000 level. No, undergrad.
Okay.
Ours are 1 to 4,000 for the 4 years. The HCI class, they did a lot of go watch this video.
Yeah, and they did a really rigorous study on it, showing that the flipped classroom was more successful than the traditional classroom.
One of the interesting opportunities I think you have here in sort of putting a lot of infrastructure in a particular place on campus,
mm-hmm.
projectors, cameras, what have you, is it gives them a reason to come
mm-hmm.
to the place. And so that I think that works really nicely with the mm-hmm. flipping.
And so with
but
a lot
I
of the...
I just haven't heard that much of that. But
yeah,
I guess
with the active classroom, in active learning is often really about flipping. They just don't call it that. Like whenever you ask the students, like, read this paper or watch this video before class, and then we're going to discuss it in class rather than me just presenting the same material over again. I mean, that's a flipped classroom just... And it's been happening long before they gave it that name.
And with our OMS, we have this online master of computer science that's gotten a bunch of buzz. And I think Rich may be talking about it later today. The people who are teaching those grad classes are having to make videos and everything because it's an online, it's structured as a MOOC. It's not just like watch the live video of the teacher. So those same instructors are then using, some of them, are using those videos in their online in their on-campus class mm-hmm. to do some of this flipping.
Computer science is a funny, almost an exception in this whole process, right? Because these are the very same tools that are used to make flipping possible are the very same things that can undo the whole point of coming into, can sort of water down this kind of experience of sitting around in the same room.
Mm-hmm.
And so you look at all the social media technologies and telepresence, all that sort of stuff. It's like after a while, it's like, why do I come into campus at all?
Well, I think the, my question with all of this, blowing up education and disruption and on is always, it's up to us to figure out ways of making it worth you spending the money to be there, right? There should be some value in coming to class. And so this sort of environment, having active learning situations in class where you're being both guided by experts and working with your peers, is an obvious candidate for that sort of value.
So if I'm asking exactly the opposite, okay, let's say that you do have a bar on your display mm-hmm. that shows those posters, mm-hmm. and it changes really gradually, so it mm-hmm. not attracts your mm-hmm. attention. Would that make the solitary experience of sitting with the computer to suddenly there's more interaction because I can see something interesting and I could say something about it. So suddenly I'm not alone online, but I have other people.
Yeah, I think there's definitely potential for that. And I think that people have tried to do that in online environments right now, maybe not with visual imagery, but with, an ongoing chat or problems being proposed and things like that. But
it's really disrupting those chats.
Those chats are really disrupting.
Yeah. I mean, so the way I think about this relationship, and Mark and Betsy and I have talked about this, is that, if we can show that it's beneficial in this context, in the studio context, and also if we can understand why it's beneficial or how it works. I mean, Betsy's anecdote about the questions for the crits, right? This, she learned this by actually doing it, right? If we can show that it works, then potentially we can figure out how to design those online tools.
Mm-hmm.
Because now we'll know, what is it about this environment that actually facilitated learning, and how can we then design a distributed environment that would potentially have the same benefits without the negatives, or as little of them as possible, like without the distraction, just showing a stream of stuff maybe wrong. As Betsy said to me once, maybe we need to get them into small subgroups so that there's not an overflow of information. Maybe we have to curate the content so that it
said this to him this morning.
That's why I remember it.
a long time ago, Betsy.
It was a long time ago.
It was like 2 hours.
So I think there's immense potential for this sort of stuff. And so, yeah, hopefully a few years we'll have.
There's also equivalent what's happening right now in teamwork and,
mm-hmm.
with Slack, right? This idea that you're aggregating almost everything and exposing almost everything mm-hmm. about the team process so that everybody can keep continuous tabs on what's going on. Now, it doesn't, I don't know, I don't believe it actually is super beneficial for very large teams, you know, hundreds of people, but for this studio size groups of you know, tens and 20s mm-hmm. is probably really beneficial. And I guess one interesting thing would be to actually consider something like that, the room as just kind of another dashboard experience for a set of tools mm-hmm. like Slack or something like that, where you're really just exposing the real-time nature of the everybody's work, but you're exposing it in a very public,
yep.
you know, all-around encompassing way, which is like more lightweight than installing, you know, NASA-style, like, bazillion screens mm-hmm. to the space mission track.
I mean, in some way, the most abstract way to describe this is we're exposing hidden digital work, right? We're using it for education, right? Or work in progress. We're using it for education. But you could imagine, you know, if it's a team doing development, you've got repos, you know, you've got all these online tools. There's years of work on program visualization, on how you visualize changes to repositories, how you do all this. Yeah, expose it. Mm-hmm. It's a design problem then, which is interesting. If you could then start figuring out how to actually capture their work in progress before they check it in, that might even be better. But it's design, right? I mean, the interesting thing for me, and I've said this to a bunch of people over the last few months, it's now actually possible to do augmented reality, right? I've been doing AR in one form or another since like 91, so I've been doing it a long time, but it was never actually possible to do it. We built systems that worked for that one instance, and we demoed them, we recorded the video, wrote a paper. Maybe we tested it with N equals 5 or something, but now it's like, okay, I want to put AR around the walls of this room. We could do it. This is still hard to set up and so on, but with, you know, with HoloLens, with all these other technologies that are starting to come out, I want to do collaborative AR. I want to display a medical scan so a team of doctors can talk about it, right? Now the question is, what do I need to display? Not, oh my God, how do I build something that we can actually use? So I think, again, what Betsy's interested in doing with the design questions, we can actually now design and then do as opposed to kind of not. So I think it's kind of cool. Time to be doing AR.
Right now, if I look at it as a scale, on one side, the students present their work one time at the end. Mm-hmm. And on the other, maybe what you show right now is almost continuous. Mm-hmm. But it also have a minus from my point of view, which I have to split my attention in some level mm-hmm. because I have to be aware of what's ever happening around. Maybe in the middle, you have things which you have intervals of mm-hmm. updates. And
yeah.
in between them, I can be totally concentrated on what I'm doing.
Yeah, and that may be what we find. I think these are the things we have to play with, right?
Yep.
And it may be different for different people.
Different
so that's where like something like the HoloLens might be helpful.
Okay.
Do you think your findings may change when increasing your number of students from
yeah.
12 to a regular registration lecture of 50 people?
I suspect they will. And I think actually we want to focus on the capacity issue is a big issue because computer science classes are not getting smaller. There's a number of faculty aren't changing and the classes are just getting bigger and bigger every year. So, I mean, I think the ideal way to think about implementing this is in a class of 50 to 70, at least on the Georgia Tech campus, which is totally different than a typical studio environment, but it's just these are the constraints we have to work in, right? And so we need to figure ways to bring the best that we can into that environment without, you know, breaking the institution and kind of those resources and stuff that we have right now. So yes, I mean that's part of the challenge and part of the constraint that we have is this capacity issue.
Okay.
Thanks. Great. Thank you.
Thank you.